conversion, and morbidity for adrenalectomy, a single institution series of 402 patients. The authors are Bittner and colleagues from WashU School of Medicine.
Thank you, Dr. Schweitzberg and Dr. Fried, for the privilege of the podium and the opportunity to share our data with you today. We have no relevant disclosures for this particular study. It's certainly not news to this audience that laparoscopic adrenalectomy is really now the preferred approach for the removal of most adrenal lesions, and that is supported by the growing body of literature that began with large case series and has now progressed all the way to more recently large NISQIP database reviews showing the safety and efficacy of this approach for most adrenal lesions. But very few of these studies show any predictive factors related to adrenalectomy. And so that brought us to our purpose of the study, which was to really investigate the predictive factors that we use to select patients for open adrenalectomy, given the frequency of a laparoscopic approach today, the conversion to an open approach, and ultimately the 30-day morbidity that's associated with those decisions. We did this by way of an institutional review board-approved retrospective cohort study using prospectively collected data on patients who are at least 16 years old, had an adrenalectomy in our Division of General Surgery at Barnes Jewish Hospital between the dates of 1993 through 2010. We defined two cohorts as shown here, a laparoscopic group and an open group, and all analysis was done with an intention to treat strategy. We assessed patient characteristics, perioperative variables, and 30-day outcomes, categorizing our complications by the accordion severity grading scale. As not all data were normally distributed, we used non-parametric analysis to compare the two cohorts, as well as multivariate regression models to define the risk factors for selecting patients for an open approach, conversion to an open approach, and then 30-day morbidity. This is just an overall patient demographic slide. You can see there were 402 patients who underwent adrenalectomy. Most were about 50 years old, female, had left-sided lesions, and 62% had functional lesions as well. When you break out the two cohorts, the laparoscopic group contained 356 patients, the open group 46 patients. This, as well as subsequent slides, will show how disparate these two groups are. The open adrenalectomy patients were about 6 years older on average, had slightly higher ASA scores, but significantly larger radiographic tumor size preoperatively. In addition, far fewer of them had functioning lesions. Continuing the demonstration of the disparate nature of these two patient cohorts, you can see that the indications for operation varied appreciably. The most common indication for laparoscopic adrenalectomy was pheochromocytoma, while for open, it was large indeterminate or concerning mass, followed closely by adrenocortical carcinoma. Certainly, and somewhat not surprisingly, patients in the open group had significantly longer operative times. That happened to be due to the fact that 63% of them required concomitant procedures, and we'll get into the specifics of those concomitant procedures in the subsequent slide. They also had higher estimated blood loss, higher need for blood transfusion, as well as a higher complication rate overall. So with regard specifically to the concomitant procedures performed in both groups, that's shown here in this table, you can see that 69% of those patients in the open group who had to have a concomitant procedure had to have multi-organ resection. That may be one additional organ like the kidney or multiple organs, and that was appreciably more than in the laparoscopic group. The remainder of the concomitant procedures shown here were not significantly different between the two cohorts. So the first objective of our study then was to really define the predictive factors for or what might be useful to help predict how these patients should be selected for open approach. And regression analyses defined that the most predictive factors were increasing patient age, higher ASA score, larger radiographic tumor size, the presence of non-functioning lesions, specific indications for operation, in this particular instance, adrenocortical carcinoma, as well as the need for any concomitant procedure. The second objective of our study was to define the rate and risk of conversion from a laparoscopic to an open approach. You can see of the 356 patients in the lap group, 22 or 6.2% required conversion ultimately, and that proportion didn't change appreciably over the time course of the study. While not part of the multivariate regression analyses that follow, We did break out of interest the difference in conversion rate between surgeons who have a heavily advanced MIS practice versus other surgeons who perform laparoscopic adrenalectomy. And we found those two rates of conversion to be appreciably different, 2.6 in the advanced MIS group and 17.2% in the other surgeon group. Back to the predictors of conversion. You can see here with small tumors as the referent, radiographic tumor size, pre-op tumor size, greater than 8 centimeters significantly increased the odds of conversion, as did the need for any concomitant procedure. Interestingly, the indications for operation in the converted patients didn't really impact their odds of conversion, although the presence of metastasis pre-op as the indication increased the odds to 5.1, but that didn't reach statistical significance. Other sort of factors that are related to conversion, maybe less so as actual predictors, include prolonged operative time greater than 240 minutes, an estimated blood loss of over 100 milliliters, and the need for intraoperative transfusion. With regard to postoperative 30-day outcomes, which we'll show here, followed by the predictors of 30-day morbidity, you can see that, again, showing the disparate groups, the open group had longer time till solid food intake, longer hospital length of stay, a higher rate of readmission, and 50% of these patients ultimately suffered some complication within 30 days. Most were minor, low-grade complications, such as wound infection, but they did have a statistically higher rate of high-grade complications as well, and the only morbidity was associated with an open adrenalectomy. The other predictors of morbidity, similar to that of conversion, was the indication for operation. And in this group, the large indeterminate or concerning mass, adrenocortical carcinoma, and primary adrenal hyperplasia all increased or predicted 30-day morbidity. Likewise, again, paralleling the reasons for conversion, large tumor size, in this case greater than 6 centimeters, the selection of patients for an initial operative or open approach, the conversion to open approach, and the need for concomitant procedures also increased the odds of morbidity at 30 days after adrenalectomy. Again, paralleling the previous results, you have the predictors of morbidity to include operative time greater than 180 minutes and an estimated blood loss of over 200 milliliters. So in summary, we feel that the patients, at least at our institution within this case series, that are selected for open adrenalectomy are largely based on their preoperative tumor size, as well as the specific indications for operation, in this instance, the large or concerning indeterminate mass and the adrenocortical carcinoma. In addition, the need for any concomitant procedure, particularly the potential for multi-organ resection, are indicators for open operation. Some of the factors that we found to be associated with conversion to an open approach are larger tumor size, need for concomitant procedure, estimated blood loss or blood transfusion, and then, as shown in the previous slide, surgeon practice type. And then finally, the predictive factors for 30-day morbidity in this group paralleled those for conversion in many ways, certainly with large indeterminate mass adrenocortical carcinoma as preoperative diagnoses, the initial selection of an open approach, and ultimately conversion to open approach all predicted that morbidity. So in conclusion, we feel that the nature of the underlying adrenal pathology, the tumor sizes as shown, and the need for concurrent procedures significantly impact the selection of patients for an open approach. The likelihood of those who start laparoscopically will be converted to an open approach, and the 30-day perioperative morbidity. So we feel these metrics should be at least considered when assessing the operative approach and the risks for adrenalectomy. I'd like to thank the Washington University Institute for Minimally Invasive Surgery, SAGES, and the panel for allowing me to present and share this with you today. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bittner. You and your colleagues at WashU should be congratulated for your outstanding contribution to understanding surgery of the adrenal. I'd like to invite discussion from the audience. There is a question that was tweeted in, and the question is, did the increased blood loss and need for transfusion in conversion to open case occur during the laparoscopic period or the open period of the case?
That is actually not something that we went through specifically, and it also complicates the operative time measure because the operative time measures are defined from the beginning of the case to dressing. So if conversion was included, obviously those patients would have longer operative times, although by the intention to treat strategy, those times were reflected in the laparoscopic group. So to answer your question specifically, to define whether that blood loss was during laparoscopy or open, it's difficult to tell, but the presumption, and having gone through the data without showing the numbers, is that most of that high blood loss is during the laparoscopic portion of the case, which is the resultant reason for the conversion.
I'd like to ask a question. When reviewing large data sets like this in a retrospective way, the question is how could we use this information to inform our judgment and our behavior? And when you're looking at predictors of conversion, I think the most important thing for us to learn from that is how can we use information available to us prior to the surgery to inform our decisions? And when we muddy this with information based on data that occurs at the time of operation, it's really too late to use this in a model that's going to be valuable for us. So you know, my suggestion would be to try to look at what is the information we have preoperatively that may guide us to whether we're going to do this open or not, or may allow us to inform our patients that this is likely to be associated with a higher risk of conversion. And the information like intraoperative bleeding, et cetera, is really not useful and I think shouldn't be used in the model. I just wonder if you would comment on that.
No, and I completely agree with the last portion of the statement, which are really just factors that may be associated but not directly indicative of need for conversion or initial selection of open approach. However, some of the variables, the preoperative variables that would be useful include what type of tumor pathology, what type of tumor size as defined radiographically by CT or MRI, as to whether or not those patients should initially be selected for an open approach or that may just be at higher risk for conversion if you choose to do them laparoscopically. Things that could be very simple. If it's a 9-centimeter tumor of unknown etiology that you attempt laparoscopically, you may have a higher reason to ensure that the room has everything ready should you need to convert, and then also know that the rates of morbidity associated with that conversion will be higher postoperatively. So it still doesn't supplant clinical judgment, and probably never will, but at least it helps provide a few data points that might be useful to select open versus laparoscopic approach and prepare for risks.
Okay. One other question that came in on the on Twitter. Do you have any information regarding the patient satisfaction in cases that were begun laparoscopically and converted to open versus those that were started open?
No, we don't in this particular study, but that would be something interesting to look at.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.